Thank you very much. Let me start or underline what Yam has said about culture, which we had earlier on this morning from the Chinese minister. Culture, of course, is described as the totality of the way of life of our people. Now, when you look at it, people will tend to say, yes, culture divides. But the way of life of people don't change. They are not too different. What people want, wherever they live, however they live, are very similar. They want to have the good things of life. They want to live well. They want education for their children. They want to be respected. They want dignity. These are basic things. And when we then look at them, culture does not divide as much as we will want to believe it does. When we live differently, we live in different geographical areas, different countries, and all that. But having said that, what really divides is our individual ambitions, be it political, economic, or social, which is superimposed on culture. And that is where trouble comes in. Now, we want, if it's economic, I want more than what probably I should have. And therefore, I will use whatever means I can devise to do that. Then, of course, it infringes on what the other person, maybe from another culture, would want. And then it becomes, culture then is seen as being divisive rather than being just the normal way of living. Now, let me, let's say, this is the situation I've seen it in Africa, and particularly in my own country. Now, when you take our situation in my country where we have about 350 linguistic groups, and three of are regarded as main groups, the Yoruba, the Igbos, the Hausa Fulanis, really when they are not, they don't have anything that they are competing for, you don't see any difference. They go to the Chicken Church, or they go to the same mosque to worship. And no problem. It is when the Igbo man wants to have something that the Yoruba man wants, then competition comes. The Igbo man will then try to get a little bit of the Yoruba man by mounting, by getting support from his so-called ethnic group, which becomes difficult. Then culture comes in, and of course that becomes a problem. Now, what do we need to do? I believe the first thing is education. We need to have education. I found in my own country that the thing that removes barrier, be it barrier, social barrier, cultural barrier, or whatever barrier, is education. Now, most of the conflicts in my country, people will give it a simplistic explanation that it is religious. But really, when you look into it, it's not religious. It's either economic or social. You find an Hausa man, a Fulani man, is a cow man. He takes his herds of cattle and is taking it away into other places. He overruns a crop man's farm. The cattle devastate the cattle devastate the crop man's farm, and the crop man then praises aloud. In fact, chase the cattle out of the way. Then the Fulani man, who is essentially a Muslim and from a different culture, the crop man may be a Dirham from Plateau or something like that, then it becomes a cultural issue. It becomes a religious issue. But basically, it's an economic issue. Yes. Let me just end with one point. You want to go?
I just, your last point. I just want to know, you talk about culture dividing, how we can use culture for peace and reconciliation. If you weave that in.
Now, how do we make use culture for peace and reconciliation? I want to give two or three examples. At the national level, I participated in the Nigerian Civil War. At the end of the Civil War, we decided to bring in dancers, drummers from across. And in fact, what today becomes the Nollywood essentially started from the Civil War, people playing and dancing and making drama. And that helped in the immediate aftermath of the Civil War. It helps. Now let me take another one, a very local one. In my own state, the governor of my state at one time decided to remove the traditional head of his own town, and it became a big thing. Eventually, when he left becoming governor, he went back to the town, and the town was divided, very badly divided. Now, I wanted to bring about peace and reconciliation. I did everything possible. The traditional ruler will not accept. Until one day he told me, he said, look, I know what you are trying to do, but you are going about it wrongly culturally. And I said, how do you want me to go about it? He said, look, in our culture, no matter what a chief does, if you are going to bring about peace and reconciliation, it will be in his palace. You don't invite a chief outside his palace to reconcile him with anybody, no matter how right or wrong the chief may be. I said, I got the message. Then I managed to get the governor to the chief's palace one night at about 11 p.m. And the chief got up and saw the governor in his palace. And the governor was rather statue. I said to the governor, well, greet your chief. And he got up and greeted his chief. And that was the reconciliation. That was the end. They both hugged themselves. And not a word was said to reconcile them. And his town became reconciled by them. Now, that's one thing culture can do. Now, I will end up with an international one. Not too long ago, probably about 3 or 4 years ago, I was appointed the special envoy of the Secretary General on the Eastern Congo. On the 8th of November 2009, we held a meeting in Nairobi. Kabila will not talk to Kagame. They will not even shake hands. 8th of November, by middle of February, less than 3 months later, they have a joint force trying to fight the rebel in the Eastern Congo. But what did I do? I realized that there was no competition between them. So anytime on one occasion I left Kabila and I came to Kagame, oh, I said I have words from your brother. He said, which brother? I said, of course, Kabila. Go ahead. What did you say? And then he said, I should greet you. He sent a goodwill message to you. So, you are very kind of, okay, greet you. For me. I said, well, and that would be ice. That was what would be ice. Just that word of exchanging greetings between two of them. Actually, Kabila didn't ask me to greet him. I created that to myself because I know that in African situation, you never refuse anybody greeting you, even if it's your enemy. If he says he's greeting you, then you may be reluctant to do it. He will still answer. And he accepted the greeting, and that was what broke the ice. So, culture can prevent conflict, it can resolve conflict, it can manage conflict.